The idea was to look into this basic structure which I was proposing before. This was the triple worlds of the Veda, which is also very fundamental for the Vedic understanding. Right. Why this scheme is important? Because it explains to us our triple world, why we have heaven and earth, for example. It's very difficult to understand why this structure is there, heaven and earth and space in between, so to say, mental, vital and physical being. And it is all kind of related to the supramental consciousness, which is of this kind, unity of one in many, many in one and many. This kind of concept which is dividing the oneness into these kind of three domains. But in itself, supermind is a link world between transcendental, which is not here. It has to be drawn next to it, to the right. There has to be Satchitananda, so to say. And the Satchitananda transcendental world will be projected in the supermind as unity, many in one and many, in the same way as Satchitananda represents it. Yeah? Sat is oneness, total oneness of existence. Chit is consciousness, perceiving that oneness. And Ananda is the projection of that oneness or emanation of that oneness. By the way, Shankara himself was talking about it in a very interesting way. He was saying that the world of Ananda is already in the domain of manyness, as emanation of that oneness. So basically that Satchitananda transcendental world is linked to our triple world through supermind. So supermind is that big antariksha. Yeah? This first linking world between transcendental and our world. It is in this supermind, in this vijnana. Vijnana is also a very good word to explain it. It is vijnana, yes, splitting world. The consciousness jnana, the light of knowledge, which is dividing world into two, or linking two into one. So two hemispheres, the transcendental and our world, are linked in the supermind. So in this supermind we have both of them. That's why it's central for us. Vijnana is the supermind. Right. And it is a well-known word, concept. It is used in the Taittiriya Upanishad. Right. Yes, Vijnana Maya Purusha or Vijnana Maya Atma or simply Vijnanam Brahma. Iti vyajanat, thus he realized, the Bhrigu, the son of Varuna, he realized that Brahman is vijnana, the supermind. So the supermind is that kind of world which links antariksha between the transcendental and this world. This is the first antariksha. The second antariksha, or the same antariksha which is kind of narrowing down to our world, towards our world, will be Svar world, another sub-transcendental world to us, between the supermind and the world, there will be a transition. And this transition is Trirochana, or the world of Svar, the world of the ray of the light, as Sri Aurobindo says. Not of the sun, but of the ray of the sun. So there will be a split from the body of the sun into the space which is no more sun. And that split will kind of reveal the ray. The ray is already separated light from the something which is not light, darkness. And there is a beautiful hymn, I think it is 540, where it is described, or 529 in the Rig Veda, where it is described how Svar world was born by pervading of the night into the light. So the darkness pervades the light. So we have the light distinct from the night. So we will see the light as separate. So this is the Svara world, which is also triple, and it links supermind with our world. And again, in our world, we have triple world, the same, following the same idea, or the concept of triplicity, where there is mind, vital, and physical, which is also triple mind, triple vital, and triple physical, in accordance with the same concept. So all these triplicities are related to this Satchitananda, or oneness, manyness, and their interrelation. It's very interesting to see it philosophically. I explained now this concept in the philosophical language, not in the psychological, as a structure. Now, when we see the our hymns, why I had to start with this, just to give you a background that we will see what I want to say about our hymns. Yes, I will come to hymns first. So why did I do this in this structure? You will immediately see it and understand what I wanted to do. Basically, I put here this world, triple world, Svar world, and then I put, instead of supermind, overmind of Vishnu. I will tell you why I did that, why I didn't put supermind. Actually, I don't dare to put supermind into this realm yet. I think it is a little bit too ambitious. But supramental overmind, about which Vintu speaks, this the first kind of outgoing, outbursting of the light out of the sun into the space, into the darkness, into the nothingness, is overmental realm, where all the gods take their functionalities, great gods. And in that sense, I would treat this realm. At least for myself, it is more comfortable to say that this is the highest of a mind, and Svar as intuitive mind, the lowest of a mind. But truly speaking, we could put instead of our mind, super mind, as kind of just to follow the structure only for that. But I would always imply that it is not the super mind per se, but the overmental realm, the highest. Well, these subtleties are not necessary now because they are related to the studies of these realms from Sri Aurobindo's view, point of view. So I'm not insisting on them. But here what we see is very interesting. These triple worlds, physical, mental, and vital, physical, vital, and mental, 1, 2, 3, are on each level, on the physical level, on the vital level, and on the mental level. And also this 1, 2, 3 in the horizontal way, we can see also them as this world, Svar world, and the supramental world. But I could also see them as the physical, vital, and mental again. The triplicity of this supermind, Svar, and our world reflected in the mental, vital, and physical, simply their essentials or their quintessence of these worlds. The very law of these triple worlds, which we have them here as physical, vital, and mental. So in a way, when I drew this picture here, and showed triple antariksha, and that was the beginning of this thinking, that these three hymns could be in the structure of this way of thinking. And you will see here, very interesting, there was a suggestion by Radhe that is it Satyamritam Brihad then on this level? And I said, no, it is not exactly like that. But then it dawned on me that it might be exactly this way of looking at things, that Satyam is that which is the oneness total. Ritam is that dynamism which reveals the dynamic relation of oneness and manyness. And Brihat is that vastness of the cosmos, of the manifestation in all the details and all the manyness of things. So basically this principle Satyam Ritam Brihat of the supermind is reflected in this triple antariksha and our triple world, mental, vital, and physical. So you see this kind of holographic picture, very strange and very difficult to catch, because it is multidimensional, so to say. It's not even three-dimensional. It's like going within and going without, going in depth, and going above and below is in the same manner, triple, so to say, in the triple fashion. So this very dynamism of Amsha, of Ritam, of the dynamic truth, reveals the vital world, the relation between mental and physical. Well, this is what I wanted to say before I start analyzing the hymns, just for you to have an idea where I am taking it from.
I'm wondering there's a similar, this is kind of, it's very hard to speak these things because it's so abstract. The relationship, this holographic relationship, is kind of similar to the relationship between the Mahabhutas and the Indians. In other words, the structure of the eightfold structure of the Kriti as it applies to us is similar to the Satyam Ritam Brihat, is similar to the relationship to mental, vital, physical. And that there's a reflection or a mirroring of a certain structure of natural law that also occurs within the individual that enables a human being to embody those same things that exist in creation, even to the subtlest level of creation, the super conscious.
You brought into picture the completely different structure of Sankhya, which is good, because it's always good to have this challenge and to see where this triple world is coming from. I think this triplicity is rather three gunas.
So mental, vital, and physical. Mental, vital, and physical are almost like like you said, this world, but they're human functions which are connected to the larger picture. And I mean, they're larger, and they're like one is expanded out to its full capacity, which I'm saying, you know, which is something is the most extended value of something which is personal.
As you see here in this picture, that the manifestation is not taking place only in the vertical and horizontal, it is going from the depth. So to say, the triplicity of the world is moving from within, so to say, from you see from here, kind of from the right to the left. That was the triplicity of the worlds. It's not only in the vertical position of heaven above and earth below. It is also heaven within and earth without, as you like. So, and in that sense, it is holographic. So the movement of the oneness from within to without, or from above to below, is a perception of the embodied being here, standing on Earth with particular gravity and so on, gives this kind of symbolism of above is something subtle and below is something gross. But truly speaking, the picture might be seen differently if we take it as an embodiment from within to without. If, same principles. So I kind of overlap two principles here. And when you bring Sankhya and all the senses, indriyas, what you do, you already bring the Purusha Vidha. You bring the embodied consciousness of Purusha, which is added to this picture. This is the principle of three gunas, yes? Of Rajas, Tamas, and Sattva. Sattva will be Satyam, Rajas will be Ritam, and Tamas will be Brihat in this sense. So to say, they will be going in the direction of embodiment in the material universe, so to say, fixed in a particular format, from the most general of a kind of taking oneness of sattva towards tamas, which is unique in its embodiment. And here that can be applied, yes, from Sankhya. But Sankhya is already totally mental construct, which is also helpful because there we have five indriyas, so to say, faculties of consciousness, embodied in material universe, in matter. And they represent Purusha. We don't have here anything about Purusha, notice. There is no word, no structure of the indriyas given, of the faculties of consciousness. For us, here it's a principle. By the way, Veda is very unique in that sense. It doesn't treat these faculties of consciousness, which are later so important in Upanishads and Sankhya, is not treating them here as important. They are rather representatives of these cosmic movements of consciousness. Each of these cosmic devatas or principles has all of them, has word, mind, vision, hearing, set of all of them. They are not really distinguished as separate and important to deal with. Yes, here and there we hear about the word as the importance of the words, of the hearing, of the seeing, yes. But relating to these cosmic movements rather than related to the human beings, something like this, you know, or human perception, individual perception. So in that sense, Veda is a bit different. It doesn't deal with individual psychology. It's a psychology of universals of some kind. Yeah? At least I haven't seen it being really actualized that in the Vedic text, especially in the Rig Veda, there will be something of the kind. Maybe in the later parts there will be more of it closer to us. But in the central part, in the oldest hymns, you will not find it. This distinction I wanted to make because I want to see the difference between structures. And knowing very well Upanishads, that's why I was telling you that for us would be good to see Upanishads from this perspective, what was different from the Veda. Because usually whatever I know from the studies available today in the world, the distinction is not clearly made. And if it is made, then it is always given in the way that Vedas are more archaic and barbaric and cryptic, and nobody knows what it is, it's only mantra, only sound. There is no analyzing of the structure, there is no analyzing of knowledge. So there is no knowledge in the Veda. That's much I learned from the books I read available today, except, of course, Sri Aurobindo. Sri Aurobindo was the only serious scholar who studied it from the point of view of knowledge. Others are just playing around with it. It's important. Yes, it's a very nice mantra, you know. It pacifies your mind. It gives you, you know, wealth. You go to the temple, you do some, you know, voodoo, and you get something, some result. Your children pass exams, and you have a good marriage for your daughter, and so on. No more than that. So nobody knows what is really there, and nobody wants to know, because it's too difficult, too cryptic. But in the Upanishads, we have a shift towards the faculties of consciousness. There will be... Upanishads are talking mainly about faculties, you know, about word, mind, speech, and so on. Hearing. They don't speak about gods. And what Sri Aurobindo does is very interesting. He says, "For in the Upanishads, these faculties are gods." This is Adhidaiva. And I saw it. It's really so. But they are kind of already related to our individual psychology, into our...
That's what I was saying. The fact that all these cosmic factors, these cosmic worlds and cosmic faculties and layers are also completely, or at least appear to me, and the gravitas as well, as we talked about before, they seem to be absolutely completely related to...
Right.
As individuals, and that as individuals we are functioning and expressing, I guess, or projecting those principles, the greater principles that exist cosmically and also individually, the point and the infinite. Are really just different aspects of the
soul. Right. Well, if we take, for example, Taittiriya Upanishad, and we can relate it very well here, we can see that there are five Purushas there. The first Purusha is the relating to earth, to this most surface consciousness, yes? Then there will be Purusha made out of prana, pranamaya Purusha, then manomaya Purusha, that mental being, yes, this is heaven and earth, our egg. And then there will be vijnanamaya Purusha, this Purusha, which is relating to here, so to say, to round this bigger body. And then there will be anandamaya Purusha, which relates to the transcendental. Basically, they changed the direction of thinking into more structured mental kind of, symmetry, which is easier understood by us. They have hierarchy in one direction, so to say. And here there is no such thing. There is no hierarchy in one direction, and that's the difficulty of the Veda. They didn't care about the symmetries. They didn't want to satisfy our mental curiosity or need to keep it in the structure. They didn't build the structure. So now to reconstruct, to give the structure to this unstructured vision is kind of a challenge. But we are trying always to relate it to our mind and to make sense that our mind will understand and will be able to dwell on it. But it is always approximate, you know, because there was no such task for them. But Upanishads are very easy. I can explain everything from the point of view of Upanishads, the same vision, in their language. But to keep up with Vedic language and not to really dilute it too soon, you see, and not to interpret it too soon, conveniently, as many did, by the way. So, in that sense, what I tried to do here, but it is very daring proposition, and I'm not sure about it. But what it gave me, I will tell you, what I learned new from this structure for myself. I learned something very interesting, the relation of Ashwins to Indra. And I understood why Ashwins are doing and what they are doing and representing. You see, when we locate them there in this structure, we see that they are mental realms, triple mental realms, which is acting in a very strange way. They are two. You know, the mental capacity is always double. It is always two. Thesis, antithesis. Sri Aurobindo describes mental capacity, mind, manas, as the capacity to hold the image of things, to concentrate upon anything. It is the major capacity thing. It is holding in the light of consciousness the image of things long enough for consciousness to recognize what it is. And Ashwins are related to Indra in the Veda in such a way that they represent Indra, by the way. And in the later tantric tradition, also there are very interesting texts representing Ashwins represent Indra as Ida and Pingala of Sushumna. Sushumna is the central breathing space in our subtle body, Sukshma Sharira. And left and right, there are two channels. One is cooling and other is heating up. Yeah? And these two channels are balanced of the sun and the moon, so to say. Balanced by that Sushumna. And Indra is also using Ashwins many times in the Veda in a very strange way. They are representing his movement. They are bringing not only their merit to the Surya and bringing Surya in the chariot, and they are related to the dawn. And not only that, but also this double aspect of Ashwins, one is representing knowledge and other is representing power, Sri Aurobindo describes. By the way, we would never know about it if Sri Aurobindo would not say it. And that makes totally sense because they are on both sides of the vitality, bringing this mental power and making the mind able to hold any image of things. Because what is image of things is the representative of power. And the light of knowledge from one side can hold the image of things as the creation of power within one complex. So consciousness can dwell on the image of things and hold it. And that is the duality of the mind, which Ashwins represent. It's a power. It's a power which works in the vital as a mental power. Ashwin is the rider on the horse, on the vital energy, who can hold any image of things in the vital. And by this invite the consciousness. And that is the intuition I got from this scheme. Suddenly I understood why Ashwins take this position. It's maybe too early to say about these things. It's just a thought which crossed my mind, but it was a very pleasant thought. You know, when it comes, it brings delight, and then you know that there is some truth in it. By the way, there is only one criteria of knowing whether it is true thinking or not, that you get peace and delight and light and happiness. And once you get it, then you know that there is some drop of truth in it. So worth looking for it. Mm. And then you can see that,
is
it too difficult and cryptic what I'm saying?
I have a question about actually. So the riders on the horse, the ashrams, bring the ability to hold an image of something long enough for the consciousness to take it over.
Right.
And then at what point, and who is the devata whose awareness follows that if it's good or it's not good, or if it's useful or it's not useful, or I'm going to store this here, or there's some discernment or discrimination about
it. Right. You're talking about some kind of soul's capacity. By the way, these are all faculties of the soul, all these devatas. Yeah? So these are movements of our consciousness, of our conscious soul, in different faculties. So these are the cosmic faculties of the soul. Of course, Indra will be the one who will be coming and kind of bringing the light and kind of illumining the truth. And that finger of light, or that, lightning bolt, which is flashing from the above, which Indra brings, is showing us the truth of our being. But to show it, there has to be some action done, some holding, in the consciousness, in the mind. And this capacity to hold the image of things, what we want to know, long enough, prepare it for Indra, and can be that exactly that capacity of these double twins, Ashwins, who are the capacity to hold it in the vital realm. That means in the life realm, the images of life realm. That's important. So that Indra can come with his light into the vital realm, not on the mental level. But they are the mental force, the mind force, and relating to the vital realm. Vital realm is pure vayu. There is something else going on there. There is life force moving. But Ashvins, and Ashva is the vayu, Ashva. But Ashvin is the one who possesses vayu, the possessor of vayu. And they are coming from the mental realm, I think so. Actually, they are from the supramental realm, the supramental force, acting upon the vital level. But as a double force of chittapas or chit-shakti, they would be the most fitting to the mind, capable of concentrating on anything. Our capacity to concentrate on anything can be related exactly to this ability of Ashwins to be together, of the light of knowledge and the force, power of the object. The light of knowledge and the object as a power can be held together. Because it's...
That's why I asked about the senses, because in order to, it seems like you still, there has to be a perception of something in order to be conscious of it, right? I mean, you still have to have a perception.
Right. We are talking now about the manas here, and it's kind of interesting that you bring perception as something separate, because perception is the concept from the mental structure of consciousness, which is developed later, already when these cosmic movements are forgotten totally. Then there was a development of the individual psychology, individual consciousness, where the perception was the result. Now, to cross all that development from here to there is kind of a challenge. Nice challenge, by the way. but I see how many things are in between standing, and need to be incorporated to make that bridge between perception in general and this kind of action of Ashwins as holding the image of things by the light of knowledge. And that is most probably perception also. What Radha says is also very important, that what is healing, by the way? I was thinking about it. What is healing? Healing is the correlation of the power with the light of knowledge. So the power is the being, yes, which kind of lost its correlation with the light of knowledge. Once they are harmonized, the consciousness and power within the being, and Ashwins represent this harmony because they are two who are always acting as one. One is power and other is knowledge, and they are always coming together. Wherever they go, they will make this harmonization of that disharmony of the being with the consciousness. They will put them, together again. So when if it will be in the hearing, it will be the healing of hearing. If it will be in the sight, it will be healing of sight. If it will be in the physical body, they will give the physical healing. Yes, because there will be a correlation with consciousness, with proper consciousness of that physical body. So to say, they will always do this matching of the two, of chit tapas, chit shakti, which they represent. And that is also the capacity of the mind to hold the image of things. That's what I wanted to say. Because what are we holding, actually? What is this image of things? It is the creation of power, of the being manifested, so to say, the image of this being, of its own powerful formation, of the body of this being, of the self. Now, I take this image, and with the light of knowledge, I hold it. That means I correlate it with the consciousness, the light of consciousness, which is proper to this formation. And this correlation is exactly that ability of the mind to concentrate. You see, that was my intuition about Ashwins, why they are put into this kind of slot of the mental being holding the vital. Behind them there is Indra, who will bring the proper higher light of knowledge and make the change, so to say, will illumine or will destroy. And that Indra belongs to another realm, to the transcendental, to the link world. And he acts with the light of the sun. Though Ashwins are also the children of the sun, they are all children of the sun, basically, because they all carry the light. They are devas, from Rudiv to shine. they're shining beings, yes? Even Vayu. So that was my intuition about Ashwins. But if we look at Agni, what would be interesting to start from the beginning, we will see that Agni is on the physical level, Agni is on the Svar level, and on the supermind level, Agni. Agni, 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 on all the levels. And that is also very good, actually. It explains a lot about this Devata. Agni is all around, on all the levels. He is not only the essence of the earth, he is also the very substance of the Indra's thunderbolt. He is the light of Mitra and Varuna. He is the light of Vishvadevas, yes? So he is everywhere. And in that sense, they didn't find any other devata in the first hymn to put here on all the levels. At least I was happy with this, that Agni is everywhere. It makes sense to me. After studying many hymns to Agni, by the way, my dissertation was about the Agni, you know, yes? Agni in the Veda. So I kind of examined many hymns just to see what this mystic god represents. But the point is that Agni is really unique in that sense, because it is it's everywhere. It is the essence.
How could it be that it was first? This was the first thing that came out from the
sun.
Nothing to illuminate the world. It would have to be something that's encompassed.
Right. There is a wonderful work of Sri Aurobindo, Hymns to the Mystic Fire. Nothing better I have ever read. He has an introduction there. You please read that introduction if you don't read his translations. It's something unique. And there he explains the Agni. He gives Agni a different definition as the divine will. And I like this definition. It fits to really to everywhere, wherever you meet Agni in the Veda, the divine will. It's a willpower of the divine to manifest. So it is the will which brings all the gods and devatas into action. That's why it has to be on all the levels. It will bring them in. They will listen to him. They are him. And there are hymns in the Rig Veda where it is described that Agni is every devata. It is said that Agni is Mitra and Varuna, and Agni is Indra, Agni is every single devata, because they are of that substance. They will be acting according to the will of Agni, of the divine. And that's why he is in the essence of the earth. He reaches out to the surface of consciousness and brings other faculties with him from within himself or from above. It depends how we see it. I think it is from within himself he brings all of them. And so that's why he's on all three levels, and that's why I was happy with this structure, that it didn't really fail me here, because my understanding was also like this, that Agni is reaching to the depth of the divine consciousness. And then on the vital level, it's very interesting. Vayu, it's proper, yes, on the surface. Indra Vayu is in the middle, in the vital world. It's also very significant that it's no more just Vayu. It is Vayu with Indra together. And definitely there will be Ashwins there. But it is not important. You cannot mention everyone in a brief kind of hymn. But Indra-Vayu connection is essential. And then we have Mitra and Varuna, Sat-Chit, so to say, acting from within, from Antariksha level. And that is the supramental influence on the vital level. Because basically, supermind is the biggest antariksha. So to say, it's a triple antariksha here, what we are looking at. Vayu, Indra Vayu, and Mitra and Varuna. This is the three levels of the deeper antariksha. The world within the world, so to say. The split within the world, through which all the devatas of the from the supreme and the inconscient can come in, all the creatures, into the surface of consciousness. So basically, this would be Mitra and Varuna is still puzzling me here, but I leave it at now. When I will have some intuition, I will share with you. By the way, I was thinking to write here or not this kind of, you know, that the first column here, the first to the left, would be physical, the second column will be vital, and the third will be mental. And then I thought I will not write it because I put here above the world Svar and Overmind. But this Svar world, this triple what I wrote here, world Svar and Overmind, is only reflected in our triple world. We cannot reach to them without this our triple world, you see. So to say, it is three within three, you know. And it is true. What you are describing is exactly this, that this would be Indravaya will be the influence of mentality over the vital nervousness system of the vitality, and then there will be discriminating mentality. So mind, mental vital, and we finally have vital pure. So this is the triple depth of the vitality, or three antarikshas in other language. So I don't have problem with changing language in that direction. Still, the scheme is kind of giving us a way of locating things and thinking. On the mental level, is clear for me now. Vashvins Indra, Indra is pure Svar world, and Vishvadevas is something new for me, because they are located in the highest, in the deepest, in the most cosmic position of the mental realm. So to say, the highest, the most harmonizing movement of all the gods, cosmic gods, yeah? Where they are all coming together and making this sacrifice available for all movements in the world and all times. What is interesting here in this scheme, that the tenth one is that which is going beyond, is Saraswati. And that is something beautiful. You know what it reminds me? It reminds me of these Navagvas and Dashagvas. There are nine rishis, which are called in the Rig Veda Navagvas, the nine rays. The nine rays of consciousness, these are the nine rays, from one to nine. Yeah? From physical to the mental. These will be the Navagvas. And there is the Dashagva rishis mentioned when they find one more rishi, Ayasya rishi, who is joining them. Sri Aurobindo even says that sometimes it is even compared with 9 months of the year. So Navagva rishis are the 9 months during which the sacrifice is done. 9 months are not enough to reach out to the supermind, to the truth. So they need the tenth one. And the tenth ray, or the tenth month, or the tenth level of consciousness is that which is breaking them through and bringing them to a new dimension. And that is the tenth one here, which is coming to the supermind, or here put over mental, but we can put supermind. And that is Sarasvati. And if we read hymns, these three last verses to Sarasvati, we will immediately see it, why it is so. And Sri Aurobindo's comment on it also explains that it brings that dimension of the supermind into action. Supramental word, vision word. So that's basically it. Here we have all of them 30 verses, 30 Gayatri mantras in one setting. 3 times 3 times 3, so to say we have 27, and 3 more. Kind of interesting, yes? 30. Maybe we don't see everything, and definitely we make some mistakes here and there by defining certain things, but we are looking for the answers, so we don't have to be perfect or correct even now. Anyhow, one has to continue to look into this. Can be very much so. I think you are maybe even right. If we really look into the ritualistic practices, we will see starting with Agni and finishing with Vishvadevas here, you know, this corner, and starting from here, from this corner to this corner, is the whole kind of sequence of the day, so to say, from morning till evening. And there will be something to break through Sarasvati. There will be another dimension which has to be invited, so to say. These Navagvas are totally kind of, if you read about them, they are already complete in themselves. They cannot do more than they did. That's it. That exhausts the possibilities. Yes, Navagvas. 9 rays. These are 9 rays. But then there is this miracle happens, and this miracle is very interesting because Ayasya Rishi comes to them not by their will, so to say, but by the will of Indra, by the will which is coming from above, so to say, breaking through, reaching out to them. Once they complete this sacrifice here, from the morning till the evening, as you say in ritualistic language, then there will be a possibility of that transcendental world answering to them and reaching out to them and making them dashagvas, so to say, adding to them one more dimension which they can't have. What they can do, they can fulfill these nine rays. We can fulfill this fully, our setting, yeah, all our levels of consciousness, from physical to total mental development. But we cannot go beyond it. That beyond can reach to us. And that is always mentioned, that that beyond is breaking to us rather than we are coming to it. Right. Sure.
Now, it seems to be that it seems to hold the same concept of Aditi.
Sure.
As Saraswati.
Sure. So Saraswati here represents the action of that higher consciousness in terms of the word. Word is exactly that action of consciousness, which is. Basically, we can read Saraswati three verses and we immediately see what she does. Yes, she really changes the whole thing dramatically. She brings the great flood here. She reveals she kind of illumines all our thoughts, so to say. Makes them, she brings all these sumatis, perfect thoughts with her. She brings these, or awakens Chodayitri, these dawns within us. She transforms our being here. That is the action of Ayasya Rishi when it reaches out, when Navagvas become the Shagvas. Navagva. Nava means nine. Gva means Gau, the ray of light. Nine rays and 10 rays, rishis. It's a constant topic in the Veda, because these Navagva and Dashagva rishis, these are Angirasa rishis, but in two different qualities, in 10 rays and 9 rays. 10 rays are realized rishis. 9 rays are still on the way. So here we have 9 rishis and we have 10th one, in a way fitting into this concept of the development of consciousness. And after these three hymns, it's interesting that these are three hymns, we have the fourth one, which is again back to Indra. So to say, it starts something else. These first three hymns is a one complex finished here. I looked into the fourth hymn, it is in itself something else, independent. Yeah. I'm sorry, it's a little bit cryptic because nothing is definite here and final, but it is a kind of structure which may help us think and find ways of explaining things and relating them. If I would put, for example, not in this way, 1, 2, 3, as I put it here, up, yeah? I put it in this way, in the depth, 1, 2, 3. It would not change a thing. This is what I want to say. And if you see that, you would have a glimpse of that holographic insight which I got. And I thought, wow, let me try it again. It really doesn't change a thing, because these are the same mental, vital, and physical world here, in this triple 3x3 within the physical, within the vital, and within the mental, because of depth of consciousness.
And then we can overlay the satyam.
Right. 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 And that is also very good insight which you brought with this asking this question, and I didn't have that time right answer. But I felt that rhythm relates to the vital world, because there this kind of oneness and manyness kind of coexist or correlate or work together. Because in this dynamic truth, there has to be the multitude of things and the oneness of things, where the Ansha level is active. So that is also again in this picture. By the way, it explains why we have triple world. To me now it's becoming clearer to me than ever before why we have this heaven and earth here in this hierarchy, because we have this heaven and earth here in this hierarchy, you know, in depth. Right. So here we can see that heaven and earth are actually one being. It's just the way how it manifested it. The oneness of heaven and earth about which Bindu speaks and the Veda speaks, you know, making heaven and earth one being, is the supramental oneness of them, which is coming from the transcendental oneness of the of this unity and diversity, which is one there through dynamic truth, being manifested on the surface as two different beings in the vertical kind of hierarchy, heaven above and earth below, you know. But truly speaking, it is one being, heaven and earth, father and mother, equal and one, as Shubhendra says, heaven and earth equal and one. So earth was not lower being or you know, it was the part of the heaven. And by the way, you find these insights throughout in different literature. For example, you can find it even in Christian literature. At the beginning was the Word. The Word is the earth. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. There was oneness of the meaning and the Word. The artha and the vak, the heaven and earth, the father and the mother. And then they got split. And the split of heaven and earth is the beginning of creation. The difference was introduced. And here this difference in depth, where it is coming from, how it was introduced to the surface through these levels of antariksha, or these levels of differentiation between heaven and earth, between oneness and diversity. So it's a very good philosophical concept.
Veda, so maybe this concept of triple, you can speak of her being
all right. All right. You mean Bharati and Ila?
Yes.
Yes, also interesting, could be, because they relate to this Satyamritam Brihat in some way. That is a revelation of the, this is revelation of the vision of the hearing and of the discrimination, as Shubhendu would put, of the word, of the sight, and of the discrimination. It's also interesting. It's intuition on three levels, of the sight, hearing, and tactile. So on all the levels of mental, vital, and physical, if you like. But it is this consciousness acts on every level. It cannot be split into the domains. These are all three constituents of the same consciousness acting. But interesting thought. Can be. One has to look into it. Can be. With dawn, with Usha. Right. There is much to look into this, their relation dawn, why they are preceding the dawn and why they are carrying the dawn, or Surya, or the dawn sometimes in their chariot. And dawn is also a unique thing. It is something, it's an illumination of consciousness within the physical. It is not within the kind of its own domain on the mental level only. But look at these definitions. It's kind of interesting. If Ashwins are here in this realm of mental, vital, mental, and physical mental, bringing the light of the dawn, so to say, the dawn is that already an influence over the being, so to say, matching the being with consciousness, which Ashwins represent, yes? Holding both in one, the consciousness, the light of consciousness, and the power of the being as one being. And in that sense, they can bring it to the physical level. That's why they have influence over the physical. And here we can see that this triple system is unique in that sense that physical mental represents the influence of the mind over the physical. Though it is in the mental realm, notice, it's mental, but it is reaching out to the physical. So physical mental and mental physical, so to say, physical realm would not be able to appear if there would be no physical mental, because physical mental makes a construction of the physical realm in the mental terms. It gives it structure. It gives its relations, meaningful, conceptual, conscious relations, that this physical can appear in the form of the physical reality. So it is like world within the world. So there is no physical without mental and vital. Mm-hmm. And there is no mental and vital without physical. Notice. All these levels are interdependent. And Shubhendu says that we cannot develop totally the mental world, the mental structure, the mental consciousness, without developing physical. And here is something very interesting. That's why they insisted on karma yoga in order to develop mental capacities. They say that totally to develop mental capacity, we must develop physical body. So you see the sacrifice which Navagvas did, developing all nine levels, is a very complex system. It's not just a being sitting there somewhere, you know, meditating and leaving this world for the other world. It is more dynamic and more complex than we think. It's also an interesting thought. It's not just giving away this world and leaving it, you know, as it is in post-Vedic literature. We have only this evidence of the yogis who are kind of, you know, mortalizing their body, killing themselves slowly by just reaching out to the transcendental consciousness. And then they cannot come back because they burned all the bridges, yes? And that's what Sri Aurobindo mentions when he met with the yogi in Himalayas, who lived many years. He said he was more than 100. And he said, when they discussed this yoga, what Sri Aurobindo was talking about, he said that I cannot come back. And if I would know about this way, what Sri Aurobindo was talking to him, he said he would do yoga differently. He would not burn the bridges. He would not burn all those links which are necessary now to act upon the world. Now he got the higher consciousness, that yogi. He is in the transcendental world, in eternal bliss and so on. But he cannot come back. There are no instruments. He has to build them. It's a long time. It's a thing he destroyed. So he has no influence over the nature. He cannot transform anything. He can be in his bliss. That's it. As Mother says, these yogis are useless for manifestation of the divine. What they did, they ran away from the work. They went away into their, you know, blissful state, and they stay there and useless for any transformation here. Because they don't have influence over it. So Vedic yoga was a bit different. It was implying this work within the physical, bringing these devatas, these godheads, into the physical and letting them transform the life, making it immortal here. Right.
Isn't that what the sacrifice is?
Right, it is the sacrifice. Makes sense.
Mm. Yes,
right.
That's the first time I've seen it from that perspective, and I just days I lay in it, just couldn't get it out of my mind. It's such a different perspective.
Right. We all are brought up with this division on the consciousness and nature, you know, on the spirit and nature. We are all. And when we come to this vision, I understand very well what you had, what kind of feelings you had, because I had the same. And I have always this, well, that makes totally sense. This all world is one. A definition of the spirit. It is the embodiment of the spirit, manifestation of the spirit. It is not something else here, you know, as we think always, oh, this is here so dull and there is so nice. And the split, it's not like this. We have to, we came here for the reason. Of course, there was no way to keep these two in the dynamism which it was there in the Vedic times. That's why Sri Aurobindo says Vedic rishis failed to transform earthly life, earthly kind of nature. And because of that, there was a split on two different traditions. One was Advaitic, holding the spirit, preferring the spirit over nature. That was the whole Eastern tradition and traditions. By the way, not only one, but many of them, all these religions in the East will, prefer the spirit over the nature and will say that nature is the kind of imprisonment of our spirit and we have to get rid of it and so on. And the other tradition went in the other direction, Western traditions, where the material was preferred over the spirit. The Chaldean tradition took more the direction of the occultism and science development and natural possession. And so they split because these two we have to hold, we have to master, but we couldn't master them together. So we split into different ways of holding them. And now we have to bring them back together. And that is the new yoga, so to say, integral yoga. Tantra actually, also, if you read Abhinava Gupta or other tantric texts, you will see that they went Advaitic way, but they still remembered the Vedic way. In the Indian tradition, they say the Tantra is the Veda for the Kali Yuga, yes? So to say, the Vedic ideal is still there of the transformation of life. It's not totally faded away, though in their philosophy they are totally dominated by Advaitic vision of keeping the spirit. Okay, we maybe stop for today, and next time we will take next hymn. Vang me manasi pratishthita, mano me vachi pratishthitam, aviravirmaedhi vedasyama anisthaha, shrutam me ma prahasihi, anena dhitena horatran samdadhami, ritam vadishyami, satyam vadishyami, tanmam avatu, tadvaktaram avatu, avatu mam, avatu vaktaram, avatu vaktaram. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.